as to his forged light engine, code manipulation may have been given a blueprint. This is the prevailing theory, though certainly unconfirmed at the time of this report. Many ask why cases of blatant hacking, where someone kills 40 troops in a span of literally a second, aren't swiftly and automatically banned by the system. A majority of studios, and presumably Daybreak Games, tend to err on the side of caution, taking an innocent until proven guilty approach for two primary reasons. The first reason is to avoid player backlash in the event of a wrongful banning, because players have the option of spending real money on the game, and unjust banning can result in an intense hostile response. This runs the risk of breaking player confidence in the developers. They start to think, well, if she can get banned just for looking like she hacked, how safe am I? The second reason is to mask how the studio detects and traces hackers. By allowing some leeway time for the hacker or a group of hackers to try a variety of methods or variables, it makes it difficult for the hacker to find a workaround and exploit the system again. Yet perhaps worse than authentic hacking are the accusations themselves. When a player takes to Reddit, Imgur, and the killboards on a witch hunt to expose someone who may or may not be exploiting the system, they develop this intensity and conviction that ultimately ruins their fun of the game. Suddenly, this righteous crusade or driven rage to undermine a digital war criminal takes precedence over enjoying their one day off to play Planetside. Players are encouraged to rely on the systems in place. If you believe you are absolutely sure you are in the presence of a hacker, report them through the proper in-game channels for a GM, who should have far better resources to judge the situation than your laggy 360p footage. Then find another fight, possibly another continent if you can help it. Auraxis is a large planet, even when a whole continent is locked. And if all else fails you, taking a break may be advisable. When players have spent long hours online, they experience long hours of fatigue and are faster to convince themselves that there was no way that lightning could have taken down the Sunderer that fast.
Wait, guys, what are we doing here?
This upcoming Wednesday will have marked 1 month since SOE's transformation into Daybreak Games and the round of layoffs that hit the PS2
dev team.
Someone
please kill this guy.
Between then and now, a wave of uncertainty and declarations of abandonment swept through the expanded community on Reddit, YouTube, and the former SOE forums. With the dust really beginning to settle, there has been a spike of activity on various devs' Twitter feeds on weapon adjustments, remodeled weapons for max units, and performance fixes, which has been Daybreak Games' stated top priority. User Shonaru posted on Reddit to explain the recent uptick in action. Quote, "Sometimes, even if it's a painful process, a big office upheaval sort of creates a new burst of energy. Some people are in a new position and are eager to see what they can do with their new roles. Or maybe those that remain are scared that they might get cut too, and as such are putting a little extra in. Maybe they've seen how the community has expressed fear for the future of the game due to the office changes, and they feel like they need to get some cool stuff done fast in order to calm our nerves about dead game. It may not be a green light for a final assurance, but players do have the right to be cautiously optimistic."
Uh-huh.
Applause, yay!
Tell me more.
Pliskin AJ, co-director of PS2 operations for Emerald-based outfit The Ascended, or TAS, released a State of TAS and PS2 report last Wednesday. The report acknowledged the drop in TAS's membership from 1,000 members to 342. But this was intended due to the outfit's recent switch in recruitment policy from spam invites with no activity policy to website registration and the low-level community participation requirement.
Shut the front door!
The result was a marked spike in outfit activity, all ratio-based game statistics, and the growth of a more mature PS2 group, quote-unquote. Pliskin AJ attributed to the improvements to TAS's core program implemented this past December. According to fellow co-director of TAS PS2 Operations, Mountain Macabre, Core is a completely voluntary training program designed to help any of our members improve their Planetside 2 experience with guides, tips and tricks on graphics settings, aiming, class discussions, and essential squad skills. While certainly not a hardcore outfit by any stretch of the imagination, the shift in direction has helped the Ascended grow from what TAS user John King called, quote, "the Zerg fit of Matherson," to a better bandwidth of brothers. The full report can be found at the Ascended.
I think he's been doing illegal substances.
These have been your current events in the past week for Planetside 2. For show alerts, auxiliary stories, and fresher news as it develops, follow the show on Twitter, at RadFreeAuraxis, or simply search for Radio Free Auraxis. We'll be right back.
Wait.
Go on.
Take some ammunition.
What the hell are we calling him on him for?
Report everyone who talks.
Oh, because he was.
Is this like a
playing new Auraxis radio?
Yeah, is this like a new radio announcer?
Is this
Smegma? Is this our Android radio announcer? New radio announcer?
Shut up!
I've been waiting 2 months for this guy.
Singer, don't fucking talk. He's doing the radio, man.
I don't understand why they put him in Ezmir, though. Why didn't they put him in the headquarters?
I do apologize for my idiot clan member here. He is a simpleton.
Why they put him in Amerish? Why didn't they just put him in, you know, the headquarters, where we, like, meet every Thursday for pie?
Look, don't question what they do with their NPCs, okay?
Because that's why. Just stop talking.
And welcome back to Radio Free Auraxis for this week's full report entitled 15 Seconds, The Fight Over Redeploy Side. Look at any Planetside Reddit page, PS2 forum listing, or Yell chat in a 96+ v 96+ fight, and you might come across someone complaining about redeploy side. The very mention of this four-syllable word is enough to create a wall of text larger than any crystal on Esimir, Rock Formation on Indar, or Ego on Command Chat. So what is it? What is redeploy side? Redeploy side is a discourteous name given by critics to the complex, overarching system in which PS2 handles troop movement around a continent, in particular the way it deploys the way it downplays dedicated logistical support and real-time traversing of the given terrain in lieu of map redeployment abuse. Topics attached to this issue are lattice lines, squad leader deployment, population limits to hexes, vehicle use, base design, instant action, and more. Yet the primary critique stems from the ability for a territory's defenders to wait just 15 seconds to redeploy to the hex's spawn room in large quantities. It is argued that despite good forward-thinking logistics, vehicle use, squad tactics, etc., defenders will always be able to mindlessly flood the capture point within the final 2 minutes. And while of course this isn't always the case, the cyclical nature of these back-to-back mass infantry charges make for highly uninspired gameplay. Conversely, the very threat of redeploy side has mandated enormous vehicle spawn capping tactics as the standard choice of offense, primarily because it works. As such, territories not designed for 96+ v 96+ often devolve into explosion spam, instant death, and one big latency nightmare. The issue runs deep and is hotly debated and contested, and for good reason. The slightest change to how troops move around the map changes how we fight. Regardless, there has been an immeasurable number of proposed changes by the community at large, a majority of them looking to Planetside 1 for solutions.
Drag out!
Yet at the core of the dispute lies the desires between those who have lots of time to play the game and those who don't. Unsurprisingly, those who don't have time to play the game outnumber those who do. And the microtransactions of the masses will always trump the loyal credit cards of the few. And despite their penchant for high exposure through Reddit, YouTube, and forums, they will still remain the few. The more complex the war gets, the more time investment is needed to appreciate the fun of battle. And conventional logic dictates that more time investment equals better battles, or at least an increased appreciation for battles. That time investment is known as downtime, or times of low in-game activity. It includes forming a convoy to the next base, flying troops to a far-flung fight, setting up a defense, and more. It is often used to discuss strategy and tactics, chat with teammates, or just contrast the relative quiet to the uproar of battle, and it usually requires more than just 15 seconds. The current argument against redeploy side is that it allows far too much battle, far too fast, and not enough downtime. Without that time to recharge and reflect, the moment-to-moment gameplay can wear out for those who play every day. User Riodite identified this and made the case on Reddit. Quote, there has been a never-ending trend in PS2 design to reduce interdependency and introduce convenience at every corner. Ranging from one-man main battle tanks to redeploy side, convenience has been creeping its way into the game. The record is conflicting with any possibility of including a metagame. Furiously chasing the concept of downtime because downtime isn't fun has killed the strategy in the egg. Before you know it, every outpost could spawn a Sunderer, then MBTs, then galaxies. Then you could deploy directly in a flying whale, all over the map, in 15 seconds. I have never seen an MMO hunting downtime that much. On the individual scale, it's probably a good thing for your average lone wolf to jump from one fight to another. But on the larger scale, it boiled the strategic aspect of the game down to a ridiculous game of cat and zerg. Whether it is traveling, resupplying, healing, or repairing, everything seems to be drastically easier than PS1. Even spawning is convenient, but there is such a thing as too fast, and redeploy side proves it. Unquote. In an interview with Kid Riot a week and a half ago, former creative director of PS2, Matthew Higby, while never using the word redeploy side, expressed his desires to make a better metagame through more meaningful territories. At the time of this report, Daybreak Games has yet to reveal plans to overhaul or revamp the troop redeployment and distribution system, though they are certainly aware of the ongoing discussion. What we do know is that this is an issue that affects core gameplay. We know it's an issue that will require an enormous amount of planning and effort to put to rest. And we know it's an issue that won't be solved in just 15 seconds. We'll be right back.
I like the flashlight effect, that's good.
Take some ammunition.
That's so scary. He turns from a black guy into a white guy when I'm flashing on his face.
That's dumb. That's like saying the dress is white and gold.
And now for your continental weather update. All numbers are in degrees freedom. Amerish, 77 degrees. Esimir, negative 43. Hausen, 56. And Indar, 108. And for your warp gate traffic report, Amerish is experiencing slight delays. Esimir and Hausen are all clear, and Indar is shut down due to excessive spandex. And for your members only double XP weekends, Friday, March 20th through the 23rd. Friday, April 24th through the 27th, and Friday, May 22nd through the 25th. And now for your server smash schedule. All times are Saturday, Emerald Standard Time. March 14th, Emerald vs. Cobalt, 1700. March 21st, Briggs vs. Miller, 0700. April 11th, Emerald vs. Connery, 2100. And April 18th, Cobalt vs. Miller, 1600. Make sure to check back with us here weekend nights after the primetime alerts. You can follow us on Twitter at RadFreeAuraxis, that's at A-R-A-D Free Auraxis, for show alerts and auxiliary news. This is Captain in Arms for Radio Free Auraxis, signing off, wishing you a good night and a good fight.
That's cool as hell.
That was actually entertaining.
Thank you much.
It's cool because it's like you got an actual person.
You got your bonus check.
Oh, well, he's gone.
Is he ever really here?
Yes.
That was actually entertaining. Got extra
ammunition here. He does this all weekend. I've got ammo
for you. Does he do it for other... Does he do it for other factions?
No, no, I'm trying to find the Twitter, though.
Does he do it for other factions?
I don't think so. I hope not.
I hope not as well. I liked him.
Yeah, I love this guy. I recorded that. I'm gonna stick it on YouTube.
Find out what the Twitter was. Post up on the chat.
Yeah, if someone heard the Twitter, put it on the L channel or something.